I managed to find a copy of Neil deGrasse Tyson's PhD thesis, and I spent all week trying to understand it. But it wasn't easy to read because it's 370 pages long, and theses are not intended to be read by anyone but experts on the subject. So I became an expert on galaxies. Obtaining a PhD is the highest academic qualification for someone wanting to pursue a career in science. It's been a few years now since I left my own PhD to pursue other things. Looking at Tyson's success, I thought that his career path might have been more of a straight line to get to such a level. So imagine my surprise when I read that this thesis was not his first attempt at a PhD. His line was indeed more squiggly. He started as a graduate student at the University of Texas, but felt that the expectation to dedicate all of his time to research meant that he had to give up his other interests and the rest of who he was.
And some of the other advisors, thinking they're doing me a favor, said, you know, you have this personality, why don't you become a computer salesman? I know some people who work for computers, you could become, then they're trying to do me a favor by getting me out of their community. I said to myself, if I'm gonna have to do a whole new PhD, it's not gonna be at this institution. If it's got to be fresh, I might as well be fresh in another place.
I want to read his thesis to see what kind of scientific foundation he had before launching himself into a career in science communication, to see for myself his contributions to scientific research, and to test myself, to see if I stand a chance at understanding any of it. For his second attempt at a PhD, this time at Columbia University, Tyson took a stab at understanding why the center of our galaxy is the way it is. His thesis has the title, A Study of the Abundance Distributions Along the Minor Axis of the Galactic Bulge. It was published in 1992, when he was 33. A PhD thesis, or dissertation, is an account of years of intense scientific research, and it must contain an original contribution to human knowledge. So what was Tyson's? Well, let's have a look. Chapter 1 opens with the quote, "It is important not to worship what is known, but to question it." Tyson then describes the galactic bulge as a remarkable, compact zoo of stellar populations. Let's draw a map of our galaxy, the Milky Way. This is a side-on view with many stars in the spiral arms of the disk. Around the galactic center, there is a bulge with a high concentration of stars. This is Tyson's zoo. Perhaps the main attraction is a black hole at the very center. Astronomers can peer in at the black hole, our galaxy's fierce lion, but only from afar. There's a fear of being eaten if we ever got too close, but the sun, and therefore our solar system and us, are out here, nice and safe, held by the spiral arms. Out there we have the halo, comprised of older stars and globular clusters, tightly bound groups of many stars. Here's Tyson's sketch of what he did, which is that he looked into the galactic bulge along seven different lines of sight to understand the populations of stars in the zoo and how they change as you get further from the center. The chosen lines of sight are low extinction windows through the plane of the disk. So he looked through sections of space where there wasn't so much dust and gas in the way to obscure the stars. These are images of the seven windows, and you can notice the steep drop in star density from the innermost bulge to the outermost halo. Each window is named with its latitude. The smaller numbers are looking further out towards the sparse halo. Tyson measured properties of these stars, like their chemical abundance and velocities, to answer the following questions. What is the abundance distribution function at different galactic latitudes within the bulge? Is there a smooth transition in abundance between the bulge and the spheroid or halo? If not, at what latitude does the transition occur? And was the bulge's primordial gas used completely in star formation, or was it expelled by ongoing supernova-driven winds? To measure the chemical abundance of the stars, Tyson used the Cerro Tololo, Inter-American Observatory, located in Chile. To get time observing on the telescope, he would have had to submit a proposal, maybe even a year in advance, and compete against all the other astronomers wanting a turn. Then he had to hope that on his allocated days, the sky wouldn't be cloudy, because if it is, he won't see anything. Chile was chosen to house many observatories because it is dry and with little light pollution, but every observing run is still a roll of the die. Tyson's first observing run was for one night on the 7th of June 1989. To get to the telescopes is a long drive up a bumpy, scary road to an altitude of 2,200 meters. Up there, the oxygen level is so low that you might be out of breath just walking around. So why would he go all that way for just one night? Perhaps he hoped to observe for longer, but got bad weather. All I can tell from his thesis is that he observed four fields of stars that night and returned a year later for two more nights to get the rest. Tyson collected information about his stars in the bulge and processed that data to find their colors, temperatures, magnitudes, and also their chemical compositions. He used the Washington photometric system to measure certain wavelengths of starlight and look for absorption lines. These lines indicate that some of the light that left the hot interior of the star was absorbed by atoms or ions in the star's outer atmosphere. Some photons will be blocked from reaching us, and their absence reveals what elements the stars are made of. It's not all smooth sailing, though. There are plenty of errors in every step of the process to account for. For Tyson, these included overcrowding of stars in his inner windows, causing some of the light profiles to overlap. There was also the difficult job of removing foreground stars from the images. These both gave uncertainties in the final measurements. There are many pages of data, math, and nuanced details, but Tyson eventually arrived at abundance distributions, which he said is the principal focus of the study. Doing science means making incremental changes to models of how things work. Tyson noted some existing models of how galaxies chemically evolve and wanted to see if his newly collected data from the bulge matched any of these models. The simplest model starts off with a ball of gas, and all it can do is turn into stars. No gas escapes. This is called the closed box model, and if you were to plot the metal content of the stars against the number of stars, you would get a plot shaped like this. This is the abundance distribution. In astronomy, a metal is any element that's not hydrogen or helium. That's not how chemists would define metals, but in astronomy, it allows an easy distinction between elements like hydrogen and helium that have existed since the birth of the universe, and heavier elements that must have been made by stars. Stars make metals through nuclear fusion in their cores, or in supernova explosions. Supernovae release metals back into the interstellar medium, the space between the stars, from which new stars with higher metallicities may form. A variant of the closed box is the leaky box, which allows some gas to escape out into the rest of the galaxy. The abundance distribution for a leaky box would be the same shape, but shifted to the left. The stars have less metal in them on average than stars in a closed box because those metal-rich gas explosions from supernovae are escaping. So let's take a look at Tyson's abundance distributions. Here's the first of his seven fields, the one closest to the galactic center. He measures metallicity as the ratio of iron to hydrogen and says there is remarkable agreement with the abundance distribution expected from the simple model, or closed box. He fits a theoretical curve with a yield of 1.25, which is a measure of how much metal is being returned to the interstellar medium. The x-axis is scaled to the abundance of the Sun, so 0 would be the Sun, and 1 is 10 times the Sun's abundance. Going out further from the galactic center, his next plot has the same shape but is shifted slightly to the right. The error bars are quite large, and he says that this also fits the simple model, but with a higher yield. The third plot, moving further out again, has a higher average abundance, but he concludes that so far, the region from the galactic center to 0.75 kiloparsecs away is a well-mixed closed box. A parsec is a unit of distance, but if you're more familiar with light years, then this closed box region is about 5,000 light years across. The next few fields show a shift to the left and a drop in average abundance. We might be seeing that the box is now leaking, or there's a more complicated process at hand. But there are also not many stars being measured here. The last field, out in the halo, only has 3 stars. This is them. So he doesn't really have a lot of statistics on his side here. Tyson's measurements constitute the first direct measurement of the galactic latitude dependence of iron to hydrogen in the galactic bulge. He shows that it initially increases away from the galactic center, then steeply drops off as you leave the bulge. This drop-off occurs around 1 kiloparsec away from the center, leading him to conclude that those stars within 1 kiloparsec followed a common evolution. He also concludes that the inner bulge was not significantly enriched by infall of gas, and that the inner bulge underwent no catastrophic mass loss from supernova-driven winds. He finds that the inner bulge is chemically distinct from the halo, while the transition region is a blending of the two. Astrophysicists care about these questions because any new information about the state of our galaxy helps to refine all the models which try to explain what our galaxy is and how it got here. Tyson talks about the implications of his findings for models of how clouds of gas may have collapsed to form our galaxy in the first place. There has been a lot more work done on galactic evolution since this was written in the 90s. Large-scale surveys done by satellite and ground-based telescopes, like Gaia and Apogee, have been able to create maps of millions of stars and dwarf the 3 data points that Tyson had out in the halo. Astronomy moves pretty fast, since every year there are upgraded tools and methods of observing. This thesis isn't Tyson's only contribution to research. He has 13 research papers, which all will have contributed some new understanding. Some of his papers are taken from chapters of this thesis and his failed previous attempt, and I'll link those down in the description because the entire thesis as a whole can only be found through the University of Columbia. His combined work has racked up a bit over 2,000 citations, instances where other scientists have used it in some way. Whilst this isn't extremely high, it's pretty clear that Neil deGrasse Tyson's main contribution to science is not in his research, but in his work as a communicator. His early research work was his introduction to all the key workings of the subject. We can also take a look at his acknowledgements page. He thanked the scientists who helped him along the way. He thanked his supervisor, Mike Rich, for his encouragement and attention to scientific detail, and dedicated the work to his family. He ended his thesis with a final thought: "I have lived and fulfilled a dream, yet my life is just beginning." Most of the notes I took and the facts I learned about galaxies never made it to the screen in this video, but I really feel that for this week at least, I did become an expert on galaxies, even though I might forget it all next week. I found this thesis surprisingly good at covering a base of topics that one would need going forwards to work in astronomy or its communication. And I suppose that's exactly the point of a thesis. But then success is all about what you do from here. This portion of the video is kindly sponsored by Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of online classes where members come together to find inspiration and take the next step in their creative journey. For example, there is this excellent class by Ali Abdal covering video editing with Final Cut Pro. The class could take you from having no experience to editing great YouTube videos. Final Cut is the software that I use to edit my videos, and even though I've been doing it for a few years now, I still learned a few new tips and shortcuts from Ali's class. Joining this class through Skillshare is also much cheaper than many of the other expensive editing courses out there. In fact, it can be free for you. There's a special link down in the description, and the first 1,000 people to click it will get a 1 month free trial of Skillshare. So thanks Skillshare for supporting my channel and for helping people to try new things. Also, a thank you to my Patreon supporters, including today's Patron Cat of the Day,